Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. This story is about what if Deku married Mirko. If you guys enjoyed this what if, comment down below and let me know. And go ahead and check out other what ifs in the channel. Before we start, please do support for more awesome content. Don't forget to subscribe and leave a like, and also share this video with your friends. So let's start this video. Sup nerds, Rumi hopped down between the seats of Nejire and Tamaki and wrapped her arms around both of their shoulders. Nejire because, much like herself, she was an adorable short stack that could kick far more ass than people expected, and Tamaki because it made him uncomfortable. As a member of the top-notch kickass group of UA, it was technically part of Rumi's job to check in on the upcoming students. Rumi? Mirio flailed his arm like a robot and waved at her, a great big derpy smile on his face. His punchable face. It wasn't that she didn't like him, the dude was pretty alright, just way too cheerful. He never jumped. Even when she told him he had a punchable face. He even agreed. We're just about to watch the second round, where have you been? Were you in detention? Were you? I bet you were. Nejire hummed and then stopped tapping on her chin. Nejire's kind of chaos was endearing, and she was the only person that had more raw energy than Rumi did. And she could use that to shoot lasers or some shit. Wait, no, that wouldn't make sense. The assignment was only to pick a single match or two to analyze, right? I figured, why would I bother with the boring fights? So, I decided to show up for the semi-finals. I did make it, right? Yeah. There's a lot of strong students this year. Nejire pulled out her notes and pointed at the notepad. There were a bunch of cute little drawings on her notepad, mostly doodles. Oh, like there was this one sleepy guy that could mind control people. I wanted to know how his quirk worked. It looked really fun. I wonder what it felt like, oh. And then there was this girl that could make things float. She was really cool, but she lost to a guy that made things explode. Made sense, exploding stuff would fuck up more shit than floating shit. Rumi peered down into the stadium from her vantage point and saw that the next fight was about to begin. It looked like one of the fighters was that one kid that people couldn't shut up about, Endeavor's kid or something. And then there was the green-haired kid that looked completely and utterly uninteresting. Where were the giant burly men fighting each other with bloodied knuckles? It looked like it was going to be boring. Maybe she should have waited before she showed up. Nejire, Mirio said, leaning forward and looking down at the stadium as well. What can you tell us about the next two fighters? Oh? The one with two colors and the scar, how did he get that? Is Shoto Todoroki, he can make lots of ice. Last fight he finished the guy super quick by making a glacier. Apparently, he can also make fire. But he doesn't for some reason. I wonder why. Nejire flipped through her notebook, and then peered over the edge. And him, oh, he's Izuku Midoriya. He's the one that fought the mind control guy. I want to know how he beat him cause it looked like he was mind controlled. But, he hurt his finger, and then threw the other guy out. I don't think he's even used his quirk today. Oh? Rumi let out a smile as she glanced towards the green-haired boy. What kind of insane dumbass wouldn't use their quirk through the whole sports festival, and then to top everything off, make it to the fucking semi-finals. Fuck, she wanted to try that, but her quirk wasn't something she could not use. Maybe she should try, doing it with her hands tied behind her back. Yeah. He also got in first place in the obstacle course, by using landmines to propel himself over the finish line past the others. Rumi glanced towards Nejire and blinked at her. Nejire was many things, spazoid, goofball, hyperactive ball of lesbian energy, but she was not a liar. She didn't even exaggerate, at least not on purpose. You shitting me? Nope. Mirio responded, rubbing his nose. It was quite the show. I'm sure that sir will be interested in him as well. Rumi blinked, praise from Mirio before he had even used his quirk. Now that was rare. Maybe she should have shown up a whole lot sooner if there was someone that crazy in the first years. Rumi licked her lips and smiled down at the stadium as she watched the two fighters getting ready to go at it. Rumi, Tamaki groaned, she turned and saw him blushing. Your butt. Whatever, enjoy the view, dude. She had on her sports shorts under her skirt. The worst thing he'd be seeing was her tail, but that was basically always on display. I know I am, Nejire announced proudly. Aren't you in a relationship? Oh? You're right. Rumi, can I take a picture and send it to you? For the life of her, Rumi would never quite understand how Nejire's mind actually worked. And perhaps that was for the best. Start. Present Mick's shrill voice pierced through the stadium and the entire let out a cheer. From the very start Rumi was hooked. That green-haired little bastard was fucking nuts. When she saw the first attack from Shoto, she thought it would be over in a heartbeat. Instead, Izuku did something amazing. It looked like he broke his own damn finger just to send a blast to stop Shoto's eyes. And he kept doing it. Over and over and over again. Each one tearing up his hand all the more. Seeing a fight like that, watching someone that determined to win, it was impossible for her to not get amped up. She could feel her heart beating in her chest, her ears perking up from the sheer amount of second-hand adrenaline she was getting from watching him. Even though he was out-muscled, even though using his quirk hurt his body, it felt like he was winning. When Izuku got caught and pulled back his arm and let out a punch with his entire arm, Rumi couldn't help but start giggling. It was too much. This kid was crazy. She loved it. Shoto attacked again, and in response, Izuku, that crazy green-haired bastard, broke his own damn finger to blast all that ice right back at Shoto. Come at me with all you got. Izuku's cry, that desperation, voice crack, the pain in it, all of those flaws in that cry, were completely drowned out by the sheer determination she could hear in his voice. Watching him fight, watching him go up against a foe that should have wiped the floor with him, she couldn't remember the last time she had felt something like this. From there the fight turned into a brawl, both Shoto and Izuku going blow to blow. But even then she could see it. Shoto wasn't holding back. But every time Izuku made contact, he held back. It's her power, isn't it? Rumi began to laugh as she understood Izuku more and more now. He was all the right kinds of crazy. He didn't care about winning or losing. He didn't care if he got his ass kicked, he didn't care about any of that because right now, he was trying to save the guy he was trying to beat. She watched on as Shoto's fire began to burn bright. The ice on the battlefield began to melt, vanishing into a steam, and despite everything, Izuku, that glorious bastard, decided that he should scream at it and charge up. She could tell the power in his quirk even from where she was. It wasn't limited to just his arms, but he could even use his legs as well. Izuku leapt forward, Shoto unleashed a wave of flame. And the resulting explosion made up Rumi's mind. She needed to talk to Izuku. Tamaki. You're off the hook, I have a new training partner. Thank fuck. That was by far the loudest she had ever heard that elf speak. I healed you enough, so you can walk. Recovery girl tapped her cane on the ground, and let out yet another dejected sigh. She was really really disappointed with him. She pointed towards his right hand, and let out another scuff. You should think of that crooked right hand as a warning. Wrong. She came in out of nowhere, rushing past All Might and moving to look at his right hand, a white crazy smile on her face that made him feel several things, mostly different kinds of fear. Her skin was darker than most by a fair bit, that with her pure white hair, white rabbit ears, and white red eyes made her really stand out. In a good way. In short, the pretty girl was really close and his nervousness was acting up. Without even asking, she grabbed his hand, and held it up gently. He could feel the calluses on her fingers, and could see her chipped and damaged nails. This isn't a warning, this is a trophy, a badge showing your determination and letting the world know not to fuck with you. The recovery girl decided to whack the bunny-eared girl on the arm with her cane, and promptly backed the girl into the corner. Rumi. You stay away from him, the last thing that boy needs is someone as battle-crazy as you to steer him in the wrong direction. Ha. Hey. I haven't gotten any broken bones in months. Besides. What's wrong with me influencing him? He's a good fighter already. The bunny girl, or rather Rumi, held her hands up at the staff, her red eyes focused on it, though her smile showed that she was doing this for fun, and not because she was actually afraid. He needs to learn how to use his quirk in a better way. Recovery girl pointed her cane at Izuku once again. When that doesn't involve him breaking his arms every. His quirk works with his legs, right? Rumi let her hands down and looked at him. Those are a lot more sturdy than his arms, so why doesn't he use those? Legs? Izuku glanced towards his feet. It's true that he did put a lot of power into that last leap. But, that still didn't change the fact that using one for all still damaged his limbs when he used them. That's not a bad idea, young Midoriya. I think that might have a good idea, All Might said, still in his skinny form. Of course, I do. Thanks, kind of creepy skinny tall dude. All Might looked crestfallen. Who are you? That's not important. Izuku flailed his arms and got Rumi's attention again. His cheeks felt hot when her red eyes locked onto him. She looked really cute in her school uniform, her tie was a slight pull away from coming loose, and the top two buttons of her uniform were undone. All in all, she felt like the classic bad girl type. But, what did you mean by using my legs? Like use them to fight? Rumi lifted her leg up and brought it up above her head, showing off the tight black shorts she wore under her skirt. Her legs were pure muscle, yet still flexible. He didn't even know legs could move like that, but Rumi was making it look easy. Also, her thighs. Holy shit. Besides, you'd also be a whole lot faster if you learned to use them instead of just running around pretending to be All Might. Okay, so that stung a bit. Not as much as broken bones, but a bit. Hey, I know, I like you. Huh? Rumi grabbed onto his shirt and pulled him up off the bed ever so slightly. Her face was so close that if he wanted he could kiss her. But her eyes, and his injuries, kept him stunned. Okay, it was mostly the fact that he was an emotional wreck, and that forward woman were quite possibly his greatest weakness. Starting from today, you're going to be my training buddy. So, I hope you're a fast healer. I am? Good. She dropped him, and headed for the door. Don't worry, Izuku, I'll find you. Though, was it too late to tell her he wasn't a fast healer, and he was asking about the training buddy part? Well then, All Might gave him a wide smile. I think she has a point, why don't you give it a shot? The Kuvari girl gave a groan and bonked him gently on his head with her cane. "If you turn into another Rumi, I'll kill you myself." That sounded terrifying. What the hell did he just agree to? Deku. Why the hell did he pick that as his hero name? Oh. Right. Because Ichako said that it was cool and sounded super positive and encouraging, and a small part of him wanted to piss Koch-chan off, which was easy to do just by looking at him for more than a second. But at the end of the day, his tentative hero name was Deku. Now he just needed to find an agency to take him in, and hopefully he'll be able to figure out how to use his quirk without breaking his arms. Or his fingers, or his legs, or like every single bone in his body. Repeatedly. Mostly because it hurt a lot, but also because Recovery Girl was scary, and she was threatening to retire if he kept using the limb exploding function of One for All. The problem was that he had no idea how to stop doing that. All Might hadn't been able to offer any advice, despite the fact that he too was quirkless. One for All just came naturally to him. Which meant that the amount of advice he could give was an egg in a microwave and clenching butt cheeks. Izuku let out a sigh as he followed his class out of the classroom for their daily hero training. He didn't even know what he should be doing. Sure, that Rumi girl had said to use his legs because they were more durable, but he was still really good at breaking his legs. He was well on his way to having a quirk called Bone Jigsaw. Izuku. Ichako shook him out of his thoughts as they were nearly to the transport bus that would take them to whatever station All Might and Aizawa-sensei thought best for today's training. They wouldn't even find out until they got there. Apparently surprises were part of being a hero. Why do you look so down? Oh, well, I'm trying to think of a way to use my quirk without breaking my bones. Izuku scratched the back of his head, flinching slightly at the still fresh tension there from his fight against Shoto. He didn't want to believe that what he did was a mistake, but he couldn't call it a success. Not yet. Oh? That'd probably be a good idea. It's not fun seeing you go to the nurse's office every day. Despite how sweet Ichako's words were, the truth still stung. But, if you need any help, lad. Eraser-sensei. She came in like a meteorite crashing down in front of Aizawa-sensei. Rumi stood in her hero costume, which looked to be designed to give her maximum range of motion. A sleeveless white leotard with purple trim, and a yellow crescent moon on her chest showed off her muscular arms as well as her thick, muscular thighs. I'm here to take Izuku. All eyes fell on him. Many were confused, some were jealous, and one was really, really angry. Aizawa-sensei gave a low growl as he glanced towards Izuku, and then back to Rumi. We have class, this can. Oh? This is for class too. Rumi unfolded a piece of paper and handed it to Aizawa-sensei. I already got Nezu and All Might to sign off on it, I just need your permission, and I'll be his student mentor. You're aware that student mentors are generally between second and third years. Aizawa looked over the piece of paper and pulled out his pen and signed a paper on the side of the bus. I have no problems with it, just try not to increase his visits to Recovery Girl too much. I make no promises. The short bunny ear girl all but bounced in excitement. Again. What the hell did he just get signed off on? Problem child. Aizawa called, and signaled Izuku over. Rumi's face grew ecstatic at that name. No way, you call him problem child too. To be clear, Aizawa growled when Izuku got in close. I'm signing off on this to keep him out of my hair for a while, and because I know that you wouldn't shut up about it until I agreed. Rumi gave a very sweet and completely unbelievable smile. Besides, chances are Izuku could learn something from you. You're both insane. I know, right? Rumi laughed and kicked her foot against the ground as she started to bounce. Now that he was standing next to her, it became apparent that if he didn't include her ear, she was on the short side. And that she could crush his head between her thighs, and he would thank her. What the hell was wrong with him? It's great. I can't wait to see what he can do. Oh. But don't worry, I already talked to All Might about what he needs to work on. Rumi tapped on her head, and gave a wicked smile. I have ideas. Terrifying, Aizawa grumbled and looked at the rest of the class. A sharp glare was all it took to get things back in order. That glare remained especially when it fell onto Izuku. Izuku, this is Rumi, I trust you two have met somewhere along the line, otherwise I doubt she would have signed up to be a mentor. But the point being, is that she's now your mentor. Call me Rumi-senpai from here on out. Rumi stuck a thumb to her chest, her stance was filled with pride. Basically I get to snag you from hero training twice a week, and train you myself. Now come on. I have permission for the Epsilon grounds. She tapped him on the shoulder and started to jog away from him. Wait, we're running there. Better hurry. Aizawa placed a hand on his shoulder, and Izuku saw that menacing smile of his sensei's for the first time in a while. She's in charge of half of your grade now. Izuku had no idea if he was serious or not, but chased after Rumi regardless. Along the way he learned a very important lesson, to enjoy the view. Epsilon grounds weren't nearly as far away as Izuku would have thought, located within a short jog from the main building. Where most of the other training grounds of UA had a theme such as waterfront, city, suburban, forest, or industrial, Epsilon grounds appeared to have the simple theme of obstacle. The building consisted of slopes, hoops, stairs, Mickey bars, climbing walls, and so much more, some even moving. It felt like the kind of place that belonged as a bonus level in a Mario game. Ah. Rumi gave a long stretch that started with her standing on 2 feet and ended with 1 foot in the air behind her head. Was she just showing off? If so, it was a wonderful show. He had thought a lot about her thighs recently, and honestly, he was a big fan. I love this place. It's so much fun. Izuku stood, hands on his knees as he looked at her. She was fast. Really fast. Rumi-senpai, why did you want to be my mentor? I told you before, didn't I? She asked, barely even glancing at him. I saw your fight with that Todoroki kid and decided that I like you, so now you're my training partner. But don't worry, I don't like going up against weaklings, so I'm going to help you not get broken bones when we go at it. You are? Izuku asked, still slightly stunned by the whole ordeal. Was this what it felt like to be adopted by an extrovert? I know you mentioned something about using my legs to fight, but I don't know how to use them without breaking them either. She gave a short laugh and jumped up and over him to slap him on the back. That's what I like about you, Izuku. Your quirk breaks your bones, but you're still down to fight. And you're even crazy enough to try and help your opponent get strong during a fight. I can respect that. Thank you. Don't mention it. Now then, my. She paused and tugged on the back of his hood. The next moment his hood was up and she was smiling even wider. Nice bunny ears, man. Glad to see some respect. Probably shouldn't mention that they were technically supposed to be All Might's hair. Thanks, I'm glad you like it. I knew I picked the right training partner. But now it's time for your first lesson. She flipped his hood off and strutted in front of him, her hips swaying as she did so. There was so much hip on display. So much thigh. I'm going to teach you how to jump, and then, I'm going to teach you how to jump good. But, I can already. Most of the time, when you jump you break your leg, right? Or legs. Nezu gave me the footage of your entrance exam, that was one hell of a jump. But I'm going to teach you how to do that every time without turning into a meat noodle. That sounded promising. He didn't really like being a meat noodle. Okay, so where do we start? First of all, I want you to show me how you normally jump with your quirk. Rumi placed her hand on her chin and took on a thoughtful, yet still slightly crazy look. One of her long white rabbit ears drooped at the halfway point. Well, I normally just focus my quirk into my foot and... Wait. Rumi held up her hand. You only jump with your foot. Yeah. No wonder you explode. She shouted and squatted down in front of him. Her powerful legs were like a bow ready to be fired. But it was more than that, every part of her body was primed. When you jump, you need to use your whole body. Rumi jumped. High. Really, really high. Easily clearing several stories and forcing Izuku to squint as she vanished beyond the sun. And when Rumi landed, she did so with a bang. The ground shook slightly, and she had an even more maniacal smile on her face. So come on. Show me how high you can jump. Use your whole body. No quirk. Following Rumi's instructions resulted in an incredibly awkward leap forward that had him stumbling for longer than needed. Alright, try that again, but don't jump until I say to. Rumi commanded. Well, at least she was more hands-on than All Might was. He squatted down, placing his fingers against the ground, and gathered his breath. Rumi knelt down in front of him and started to move his muscles. Her hands were small, but really strong and firm. She positioned his muscles ever so slightly, moving his foot, changing where he was looking, and just touching him all over the place. There, Rumi nodded to herself and stood. How does that feel? Tense. Like you're ready to spring up. Yeah. Rumi clapped to herself and nodded. I'm good at this teaching thing. Alright, now, when you go to jump, I want you to move every part of your body at once. Your legs should do most of the work, but your stomach, and even your arms should help, so here, do what I do. She got in position with him, and guided him through the movements a few times. Now give it a shot. Show me what you got. He jumped, this time going from a bunny hop to something more respectable. He jumped what felt like 3 feet in the air, his body flying, his heart pounding, and a laugh escaped him. He still stumbled when he landed, but this time, he actually managed to jump. Was that right? That was good. Rumi jumped much higher than he did without even trying, as though to show off. She even did the splits in the air before she landed, laughing all the way. Now try again. This time go higher. He jumped again. Higher. Again. Higher. They spent minutes jumping and getting the form of it down. Now then, we're going to try and use your quirk with it. Rumi stretched her arm and leaned down to stretch her leg as well. She really likes to stretch. It made his own joints feel tense, and he ended up mirroring her stretches. So, how do you normally use your quirk when you jump? You said you focused on your foot, right? Izuku nodded. Yeah, I. Can you focus on your whole body? Rumi bounced up and down and pointed towards her own arm. Even though my rabbit quirk makes it so my legs are really strong, I still use my arms a lot. Whenever you're doing anything, from punching, to running, even walking, your whole body is being used. It could be that not spreading out the love is what's causing your bones to break. You're causing some muscles to overpower others without the juice. She shrugged. Or I could just be wrong, and your quirk is breaking bones equals power, at which point you're screwed. Izuku blinked and opened his mouth. How the hell had no one told him this before? She had a point. The difference of power between muscle groups likely caused a bruising and tension that he felt when using one for all. Okay, I can try that. A deep breath. The connection. That raw power trembling inside of him. He gathered it like he always did. Sending it to his hand at first, then to his other hand, but that only caused the first to lose that strength. He grunted and tried again, focusing on both hands. That worked. Everything at once. One for all spread through his body, from his head to his toes. Everything tingled. And hurt. A lot. Whoa, Izuku opened his eyes and saw Orimi was inches from his face. When you're using your quirk, you get this whole energy around you, and your eyes shine. That's awesome. But how does it feel? Everything hurts. Izuku groaned. The max he could use safely was too much all over his body. Maybe if he lowered it. He sighed and tried to lower that power, and instantly he found himself able to move more easily. Ha, I think that worked. Good. Rumi clapped her hands and gave another jump. Now. Will you like that? Try jumping. Go as high as you can. But no broken bones. That's kind of a requirement. Izuku nodded and did the exact same jump he had been doing. Only this time, it was supercharged. He pressed his hands to the ground and took in a deep breath, and tried really hard not to think about the fact that Rumi's thighs were probably at eye level. If he jumped, they wouldn't be. He could probably just open his eyes and probably see them. He jumped. Wind blasted his face, and he found himself feeling like he was flying. He opened his eyes, and let out a cheer. He did it. Rumi's idea. It worked. His body hurt, but not that bad. Nothing was broken. This was. He was really high up. How did he land? Umi. He flailed his arms as he saw the ground was getting closer. How do I? Umi appeared in front of him and grabbed onto his waist. Nice jump. Next we'll work on that landing. The humiliation he felt from being rescued was greatly overpowered by the feeling of his face being pressed against Rumi's chest. Soft. Come on, Izuku. You'll never catch me like that. Izuku was a quick study. Umi grabbed onto one of the slender metallic rods that stuck out from the wall and spun around it once, twice, and then kicked her legs out, boosting her up to the next level, and onto one of the large wooden beams that stuck out from the wall. All of Training Ground Epsilon was one giant obstacle course with multiple layers, and courses that required more and more skill to get through. Umi held the record, albeit mostly because she brute forced it, by skipping over a bunch of stuff, but she could do those easily. Nejire was in second, but she cheated by flying, so it didn't count. Even if it was in the intermediate section, Izuku was handling it like a pro. With his newfound jumping skills and his, he just slammed into a pole, developing acrobatic skill combined with his new method of using his quirk across his entire body. He seemed unstoppable. Minus the crashing. Hey Izuku. Those are for jumping, not crashing. Landing is hard. Umi let out a snort and tapped her foot on the beam she was standing on. He was getting snarky too. She liked that. Who knew training someone could be so much fun? She couldn't wait to beat the tar out of him once he could actually put up a challenge. How long would that take? He already hit pretty hard. Maybe not, he crashed into the wall full force, too much longer. Or maybe that would be a whole lot longer. It was really hard to gauge something like this. Then again, she was the same way before that old geezer taught her how to jump without slamming into a wall. That was how she lost a lot of her baby teeth. It was hard being a little girl that could jump 20 feet in the air whenever she got excited. There were still holes in her ceiling that proved that. Izuku? She asked, turning to look at him as he fell to the ground. And laid there for a second. Well, that wasn't good. Stepping off the beam, she bounced down next to Izuku and stared at him. The sparky zappy stuff that meant he was using his quirk wasn't there right now, and he was just staring up at the sky, eyes open. Rumi squatted down next to Izuku and watched as his eyes flashed to her legs, pervert, and then back to her face. He smiled. That was good. You alright? Izuku blinked. My entire body hurts. But I don't think anything is broken. It feels like my muscles are sunburnt. And you are still trying to keep up. Rumi laughed, patting his chest as she smiled at him. Even if his quirk hurt, he was that driven. That was the kind of determination that made her like him in the first place. You just keep impressing me, don't you? Thanks. Izuku groaned and sat up a bit. But, I don't think I can do that again for a bit. Oh, don't worry, we were at it for a couple of hours. Hours? Yeah, I think we ditched 7th period. Rumi looked, pulled out her phone and checked the time. Yep, that's my bad, but I was just having too much fun. Can't wait to do this again. You might even be ready to fight soon. And that's going to be a blast. Izuku swayed when he stood. The 1 or 2 inches he had on her was rather apparent as she moved to catch him, his head leaning on her shoulder. I think I'm going to need that extra training. Ha! That's the spirit. She laughed, and started to carry him towards the exit. Now I'm going to take you to Recovery Girl and show off your lack of broken bones. Operation, No Exploded Limbs was a success. Is a concussion a broken bone? I don't think so. Bad news was that he didn't actually have a concussion. Bad news was that it was time for that work-study time period, and that she wouldn't be able to train with Izuku for a whole week. But well, at least she had that week off. Gran Torino, the man that had taught All Might, had offered to train him. This was beyond amazing. Not only was he going to get to meet All Might's trainer and learn more about All Might, but he'd also get some more tips to help with One For All. It really felt like with what Rumi taught him, and the great breadth of experience he was about to get, that his classmates wouldn't even recognize him. Though he was a bit terrified, because All Might had been terrified, which made him question just what exactly had happened between them. Because Izuku had only seen All Might terrified of two things before, being late, and detailed questions on how One For All worked. Hopefully, he wouldn't have been better off spending more time with Rumi. But that was probably even more dangerous than going to meet someone that All Might was afraid of. While Rumi was really good at pretty much everything and was already shaping up to be a good teacher for Izuku, there was one small problem with her. Izuku was fairly certain that he was developing a crush on Rumi. She was really forward, pretty, and an amazing hero. Well, he hadn't seen her actually do heroic work, but she was really strong. That and he had developed a thing for thighs. Prior to meeting Rumi, he had been a boob guy. Sure, he was polite about it, but boobs were boobs, and he still enjoyed boobs, but now, he also had a deep appreciation for thighs. And this was so not what he should be thinking about. He should be far more concerned about what Iida was doing given what happened to his brother and why was there Rumi in front of him? Same height, same reddish-purple eyes, same white hair, but she was wearing more casual workout attire, and there was even a gym bag hanging on her shoulder. But the real kicker was something so sinisterly subtle Izuku nearly missed it. Her long hair was pulled up into a ponytail. And it made her look cute. Izuku. She gave him a wide smile and then walked past him and grabbed onto the back of his collar. You should have told me your work-study program was in this area. This is great. Rumi. Izuku half struggled and managed to get his feet under him, while Rumi guided him to her destination with two of her fingers hooked on his collar. She could probably tell how fast his heart was beating right. What was he going to do about that? Wait, that'd be a weird thing to notice, wouldn't it? Also, this was a great position to see Rumi's bare neck. What are you doing here? I live near here. Rumi gave him a bright, cheerful smile, and there was a bounce to her every step. Now you're coming with me. There's a great gym nearby. But, why aren't you at school? Same reason you're not. Work study. Only I don't have an agency to go to, so I just need to make sure I don't get in trouble, and I get a good grade. Rumi stopped and looked at him with a big smile. Wait. I can help out at yours. But first let's get a good sweat on. Oh. I think I even have a pair of boxing mitts you can borrow. Is working out and fighting all you think about? Not that there was anything wrong with that. Rumi shrugged. Nah, I think about sex too. Ah. He wanted to hear a lot more about that. Dude, you look like a tomato, when you blush that much. Her fingers slipped free from his collar, and she turned to stand in front of him, hands on her hips, a wild glare in her eye. Who's your mentor anyways? Well, besides me. I don't really know of any hero in this area big enough to take a student. Izuku shrugged and held up the note. His name is Gran Torino. Never heard of him. And he taught All Might. Rumi blinked at him. Well, why didn't you say so sooner? Let's go see him first. Lead the way, Izuku. And if anybody asks, I'm supposed to be here. Wait, are you ditching something? Nope. He didn't believe her. That's a model shoot, but she doesn't need me there. She has two girls from your grade to look after, and I basically know everything anyways. Rumi flung her arms as she walked, her entire body moving fluidly. So, what do you think this Gran Torino guy is like? Rumi was a model. Things to Google. Apparently All Might is a bit afraid of him. Rumi's face lit up, and she even gave an extra large hop. Oh man. I bet he's even bigger than All Might is. What do you think his quirk is? Something awesome. Like, oh, maybe he's like a super buff dragon or something. Like Ryukyu. But more swole. I don't think there's anyone like that, and when I googled Gran Torino I didn't get any results besides that he taught at UA for 1 year. How much was he allowed to share? So, I really don't know, but apparently he's been retired for a while. Wow, you either pissed him off so much that he came out of retirement, or impressed him that much. Rumi's snicker struck a very frightful nerve. I can't wait to see which one it is. So where's he at? Wanna race there? Actually where? Izuku looked up at the old dilapidated house that looked like it had been retired. Here. Wait. Rumi's eyes went wide, and her smile turned even wider. You mean to tell me that All Might's teacher lives here? Izuku couldn't really believe it either, but the address was right. Should I go check? Rumi snorted and nudged him on the shoulder. Totally. He's waiting for you, right? Izuku walked up to the door and tapped on it. When he did, the door creaked open, revealing a dimly lit hallway with some red stuff on the ground, and an old man laying fast down in that very same red stuff. It was him. He was wearing a hero costume. Gran Torino. He was. He's dead. Nah. Rumi slapped her gym back into Izuku's chest and walked forward and squatted down in front of the corpse. Hey. Old man Sora. It's me. What the hell? Gran Torino shot up and stuck to a corner in the ceiling, as he pointed a very sturdy finger towards Rumi. What are you doing here? I asked for one student. Not a student and a public menace. Oh come on. Rumi spread her arms wide. Is that any way to greet me? How come you never told me you taught All Might? Because it was none of your damn business. You no fun. Ah, so this was what it felt like to question reality. Izuku walked up and looked between the pair. Rumi, how do you know Gran Torino? Oh, old man Sora taught me how to fight, because I kept crashing through his windows when I was figuring it out myself. So, the man that taught All Might, the man that All Might was terrified of, taught Rumi. That explains so much. You're a menace. Gran Torino hopped down from the wall and glared at both of them. He jabbed a finger towards Izuku. Am I invited, but what are you even doing here? Huh? I can't stop, but I... No? Rumi stuck out her tongue. Fine, I'm actually Izuku's student mentor. And I've been helping him get over his bone-breaking problem. I even taught him how to jump good. When? Yesterday for everything. Bah. Gran Torino gave a huff and picked up his cane before heading inside. Clean up the mess. Rumi smiled and winked at him. That means I can stay. When Izuku had arrived at Gran Torino's with the promise of training, he had expected some kind of secret for one for all that would help him use the quirk better. As it turned out, Gran Torino's training for All Might was simple: kick his ass until he learned how to fight, because naturally, All Might had no problems using one for all. Gran Torino's only goal had actually been to do what Rumi had done. Get him to not explode when he used his quirk. So, now, they were doing the same kind of training that All Might had done. Ass kicking. A lot of ass kicking. And a small realization that boxing gloves weren't all that soft. Rumi's fist burst through his defenses, and the blow slammed into his cheek. He saw her wild smile, her constant hopping from foot to foot making her long silver ponytail dance, and her exposed rock-hard stomach glistening with sweat. Then, he saw the ceiling. The soft lights of the gym, that Rumi had dragged both him and Gran Torino too had been more than willing to let them use the boxing ring. Apparently, the owner was Rumi's uncle, Apachai. Izuku laid on the floor and just stared up at the ceiling for a long moment. Wasn't he supposed to be learning how to use his legs to fight? Why was he getting punched? Learn to dodge, kiddo. Gran Torino slapped his cane onto the mat and glared at Izuku from the sidelines. You're lucky that delinquent rabbit is going easy on you. Come on, Izuku. You can do this. Rumi cheered, motioning for him to stand up with her gloved hands. This is the best way to learn how to fight. By getting his ass kicked. Izuku groaned and sat up and wiped the sweat, pain, and thankfully no blood from his face before he stood. Thankfully, getting hit by Rumi hurt less than slamming into a wall while he was using full cowling. But that was a small consolation prize. The real prize was seeing Rumi in her gym clothes. She was turning him into a pervert, and he was okay with this. His mother would be thrilled by him showing an interest in the opposite sex that was slightly better than stuttering. Weren't you going to teach me how to use my legs? Izuku pointed towards his legs. He could already throw a punch. We are. Rumi stopped bouncing for a second and then spun, her hair nearly hitting him in the face as her leg rose up. The blast of air from the kick felt good, and he found Rumi's legs resting on his shoulder. But, even with the most leg-based fighting style, you start with your body first, then the arms, then the legs. We're just lucky, you kind of a buff little door cake, so we don't have to worry too much about strength training. Rumi flipped her hair back and waved towards her uncle, right uncle? Appa. See, he gets it. She gave a cheerful smile, and moved her leg off of his shoulder. She started bouncing again, and gave a mock punch at him. Even though all my strength is in my legs, I still fight with my arms a lot. Sure, it's normally so I don't kill people, but that's beside the point. But I can already punch, so shouldn't we? You punch like All Might, Rumi said, waving her hand. And that's not a good thing, kid. Torino pulled himself up into the rink and whacked his cane against Izuku's calf. Not hard enough to actually hurt but enough to sting. He relies on raw power to just blast through everything. You don't have that luxury. Not right now. So we got to start with the basics. And I suppose he hasn't given you any proper lessons. Actually All Might didn't teach me how to fight. Izuku let his stance drop, and he rubbed the back of his head with his gloved hand. Rumi placed a hand on her hip, and looked him up and down. Where did you learn to fight? Because I saw you get a couple good hits in against Endeavor's kid. But, they did look pretty desperate. I've actually been looking at videos online how to actually do it and learning from everyone else. Torino smacked his head and let out a groan. I'm going to kill that damn idiot. Rumi had a much more positive reaction. She laughed and laughed hard. No wonder you're so crossed up all the time. She took a few steps forward and locked her arm around his neck and pulled him down until her forehead rested against his. The embarrassment lasted for less than a second, as he saw the look in her eyes, a wild untamed fury that was directed at him and him alone. It was a siren's call to a personal hell that would see him forged into something greater. I guess I'm in luck. You see, Izuku. I've decided. I like teaching you. I like teaching you a whole lot. So I'm excited to hear that I'm going to be your first proper teacher. So, let's fucking go. The training shifted then. From getting hit, to being shown all those things he had been guessing about. The moves he had been inventing in his head were no longer just floating in a void all by themselves, but they were now being joined, being put next to one another, being placed into a fluid order that could be swapped, changed, repeated, rearranged. Ermi had placed the first building blocks when she had mentioned his legs and when she had taught him how to jump. But now, she was showing him the blueprints. And for the first time, since he had gotten one for all, he felt like someone was finally explaining things to him in a way that worked. He did still get his ass kicked by Rumi though. Especially once she started demonstrating some of her moves on him. Technically. Old Man Sora had told them both to stay on the train. Technically. She wasn't his mentee, at least not officially from the school, so she couldn't get in trouble. Besides, she had her license stingy, and was even in her costume. She was allowed to go out and kick butt. What were they going to do, tell her off for saving people by fighting monsters? As if. Technically. Old Man Sora was an idiot for thinking that either one of them would listen to him and stay out of this fight. They were heroes. Saving people was what they did. And fight things. Especially these things. It was so durable. Ermi kicked one of the freaky looking creatures up off the ground, following it up and kicking it again, and again, and again, and a few more times, just to make sure that the fucker really felt it. You're not even human. Are you? The creature screamed and gibbered at her, its deformed limbs flexing as it twisted in the air to aim those long arms at her. Two holes in its palms opened up. Another quirk. It screamed again and then unleashed a blast of air that sent her flying towards the ground, and it flying away from her. She landed on her 2 feet, the ground beneath her cracking. That thing had multiple quirks. It was like that thing that attacked the SJ. That meant it wasn't human. Ermi smiled and wiped a bit of blood from her nose. That was some serious air pressure it let out. She squatted down and placed her hands onto the ground, shifting into a long jumping position. Hitting a moving target wasn't easy. Especially one as wiry as that. She licked her lip, flexed her legs, and then jumped. It was a small jump, just enough to get her to the top of the building. But she paused for less than a second. At the apex of her jump, she hit the roof, her leg flexing as she saw her target. She sprang forward, the cityscape flying beneath her as she chased after her target. It was getting closer and closer. She slammed down on top of it, forcing it down faster, and right before they both hit the ground, she kicked it downward, slamming it into the sidewalk with earth-shattering force. Woo! Rumi cheered and looked at her now very defeated foe and smiled ear to ear. That was fun. I kinda hope there's more of you guys for me to fight. Though, maybe some that are tougher and stronger. Like the one All Might got to fight. Still. Wait. Where was Izuku? There were more of those things around, right? Did he find one of his own to fight? Should she be worried about him? Probably. He kind of understood how to kick good, and even if he didn't, he still had his punches, and he didn't even need to break his arms now, so he should be fine. But still. She should find him so the old man wouldn't want to yell at them later for being irresponsible or something. But hey, they were heroes, and Izuku had one hell of a heroic spirit. Wait. She paused thinking about it. If she was a betting woman, she'd wager that Izuku was already fighting something much more entertaining than the multi-quirk monster things. Oh, they were called Nomu, right? Like their creator. Or what if he was fighting some supervillain or something? That settled it. She was going to go find Izuku and watch his totally awesome fight and help him if he needed it. The question was, where was he? He did say he was worried about his friend in Hosu, right? To the roofs. Ermi leapt up and saw that there was a bit more panic than she thought there was. Down the street, she saw Endeavor light one of those Nomu things up like it was the summer fireworks festival. That meant it was totally okay that she killed one. There was more screaming from where Old Man Sora had taken his to, and then. Her ears twitched. Cracking ice. Sizzling fire. Where? There? Against the setting sun, she saw a flash. When it came to moving around, it was quicker and safer to do several quick hops, a bit like really long steps, that had it rising and falling barely at all. It took her less than a minute to arrive at the fight. And she arrived right on time to see something that stole her breath away. The scene was analyzed in an instant. Injured pro hero laying on the ground, ice every from Izuku's classmate, the smell of blood was mixed in the air. And then there was the final attack. A kick. From Izuku. Its target. The hero killer. Stain. The pounding of her heart was more than excitement. A lot more. Seeing Izuku be heroic like this, seeing him struggle, and come out on top, that was the magic. That was what made her heart pound. Izuku might not know it yet. But from this moment onward, he was hers. Umi kneeled down onto the ledge and watched as Izuku stumbled after landing, the blood on his fist, the wound on his legs, all trophies of his first victory against a villain as Deku. The fluttering of wings. A silent screech. Another Nomu. It swooped out of nowhere, heading right for Izuku. It caught him by the shoulders and tried to fly away with him. Tried because she said fuck that noise and kicked that thing's wings off with a simple and powerful kick. Izuku secured. Are you in a bad mood or something? Mirio asked as they made their way towards their usual eating spot. It was their first time all eating together. Tamaki was being dragged by Nejire in a while, but that was a given. They were getting ready for finals and also prepping for their summer training trip, and there was something else. But Rumi forgot. Umi swished her lips as she sat down, first glaring at her meal as she considered everything. She wasn't really sure she was in a bad mood. She was certainly in a mood. On the one hand, she was really happy with Izuku's progress as a hero, and the fact that he had basically kicked Stain's ass was feeding her own ego hella good. But at the same time, she was fucking pissed off that Izuku didn't get any fucking credit for it. Like, what the hell? The dude was crazy. Everyone that watched the sports festival that heard that Izuku fought and beat Stain would basically be like, Yano, that makes sense. And not even blink a fucking eye at it. That was why she had picked Izuku out of all the students she could have picked. That was why he was hers. Because that small little boy, the fact that he was technically taller than her changed nothing, had peak heroic dumbass energy, and Rumi really really liked that. Like a fucking lot. Maybe she was just conflicted by what the hell it meant to have Izuku as hers. That felt like such a weird thing to define. He just was. It didn't matter what. He was. Oh, she's fine. Nejire placed Tamaki in his seat before she sat down right next to Rumi. She has the same look on her face that Yu Yu had before she finally decided to confess. Confess? Rumi asked, looking at the walking calamity that was Nejire Hato. Most people thought that the energy Nejire emitted was her quirk, and in a way they were right, but that energy was constantly emitted in raw chaotic pulses that just seemed to drag everything into it. Or maybe Nejire was just a spaz or something. Yeah. Nejire's face brightened up. Yu Yu had the same kind of grumpy happy face back then. You two are both kind of What's a good word for this? Oh. Tomboyish. Wait, no. Well, whatever, both you and Yu Yu are kind of the same when you're grumpy. Grumpy? Rumi asked, raising an eyebrow at her friend. Oh ho. Mirio let out a chuckle. Is it time for another lesson on Nejire lingo? What? It's just grumpy and happy in the same word. Grumpy. Nejire pouted. That was kind of a good way to describe her mood. Almost spot on, really. But what about confess? Well, when Yu confessed, it was to tell Nejire that she was in love with her. And she was the same. So, she must be wanting to confess, right? But to who and for what? Izuku. Oh? She wanted to confess to Izuku. She wanted to strip his pants off, pin him against the wall, and, well, she didn't really know what after that. Tried the whole kissing thing. She should figure out what exactly she wanted from Izuku before then. Because really there was no doubt that once she told him, he'd agree. That felt too easy. Really easy. She should make him make the first move. That sounded like a challenge. She liked a challenge. All she needed to do was set it up. And make it obvious. Really obvious. Izuku was kind of dense when it came to realizing things. Like, she had to remind him that he had legs after all. Still, she wanted Izuku to be the one to take charge. The idea of him pressing her up against the wall. Now that was something. She just needed to find him, right? He was probably having lunch. And there she goes. She heard Mirio comment as she stepped off of the second floor of the lunchroom. Izuku. 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 Ah. Izuku's class, and Izuku. Bam. She caught him before he entered the cafeteria with his friends and pinned him against the wall, one foot placed against the wall in part to display dominance and in part because it just kind of happened. But either way, it was probably a good sign for him. Hell, if she didn't wear shorts under her skirt, she'd practically be flashing her panties at him. And Izuku was looking. His face was red. Hers felt hot. Yep. This was that crush thing she heard so much about. But it really wasn't much of a crush at this point. She claimed Izuku after all. Umi? Izuku squeaked, pressing against the wall. If he was using his full Kyle thing, he'd probably be able to tear his way through it. What, are you doing? She had no idea. Staking my claim. She replied with all confidence. She leaned forward smiling, as she heard Izuku's classmates sputter at her. Even if Izuku didn't get that nuclear missile of a hint, his classmates did. Well, besides Shoto. That kid was just looking at her confused. More importantly, she had a green bean to distress. Claim? Izuku's voice somehow managed to crack twice in that single syllable word. Like, as a training partner. Sure. She cracked an even wider grin and, relaxing her posture as she kept her foot really close to his head. We're training again today. After class. You got that? Yes, ma'am. He squeaked. "Good," she shouted back. "And whatever racer sensei has in store for you today, you going to win, right?"
"Yes, ma'am."
She brought her leg down, still staring him in the eyes. This was going to be a lot of fun. She still wanted to fight him, but now, she also wanted to do a lot of other things.
"Good."
Her heart was racing so much. She could feel her ears were practically burning up. "See you around, Izuku." She walked back into the cafeteria in a much better mood now. Umi's training was far more intense than normal, which meant Izuku felt like he was going to die at least 3 more times before it was over. When it came right down to it, fighting Stain was easier. It really didn't help that during their sparring session, Rumi had done what he had always wanted her to do. Wrap her thighs around his head. He nearly died right then. So far today, they had ran, jumped, gotten further in the Epsilon Grounds obstacle course, and had a friendly match with Rumi promising that she'd hold back so as not to injure him too much, because apparently finals. Honestly, he kind of wanted to see what it would be like for her to go all out. But on the other hand, he didn't want to die just yet.
"Don't lose focus."
Rumi gave a brilliant smile as she spun her leg around, forcing him to block one of her impressive leg kicks. Despite the intensity of their match, he was reminded of what had happened earlier that day, with her wall slamming him with her leg. Now, everyone in his class thought that they were dating. Which would be great.
Maybe.
Kinda. Izuku blocked the attack with his arm. The padding they were both wearing felt like it barely softened anything, and if he hadn't been using full cowling at 2%, his arm might have been torn off. The fact that Rumi was holding back was really starting to scare him. When he told her that using full cowl at 5% was hurting him a lot, she came up with the idea of just using a lower amount, but use it constantly, like wearing weights under his clothes. Apparently her big fluffy socks that she wore were 20 pounds each, to help increase his strength, and to get his body more used to his quirk. Honestly, he wasn't sure how he felt about how good Rumi was at helping him figure out one for all. But, he was grateful. He pushed her kick back, and spun, attempting to deliver one of his own to Rumi, but she made dodging it look easy. He barely managed to catch the end of her hair with one of his own kicks, but that didn't stop him. Momentum guided him as he kicked up with his other leg, and made a second kick at her. Rumi didn't dodge. She caught his leg, redirected his strike upwards, and pushed him down onto his back.
"You're getting better."
She smiled down at him as she tossed her gloves and padding off. "We should call it there for the day though." He lived for the moment when she took off her headguard and shook her hair out of that ponytail.
"Sounds good."
Izuku groaned. "I'm just going to lie here for a second. You're a lot harder to fight than Stain. And he had a knife." Should he say that at the school gym? He probably shouldn't say that at the school gym.
"Doll, that's the sweetest thing anyone's ever said to me." Rumi gave a laugh, her red-purple eyes looking at him as her battle craze and intensity began to fade.
He really enjoyed those rare moments where Rumi wasn't quite as intense, that really made him appreciate her general energy that was borderline concerning.
"Though, I'm still a bit miffed that you got no credit for that.
I saw the ending. You deserve like 3 medals. If it makes you feel any better, Endeavor really hates that he got credit for it too.
Like I care. I'm more concerned about you."
Without warning, Rumi fell down onto his stomach, knocking the air out of him for just a second, as she lay there staring up at the ceiling with him.
Why?
What was happening?
What should he do?
What did this mean?
Was this training?
Was this a Rumi thing?
Was this a sign?
It felt like a sign.
Was she okay?
She looked okay. She was even smiling at him. Her ears were slack as well, that meant she was at peace or something. And she looked happy. He felt happy. Why was she on top of him? What was going on?
Wait.
This was Rumi. She was honest and blunter than the broadside of a barn. He should just ask her.
Rumi. What's happening?
I'm flopping. It's a rabbit thing. I do it when I feel safe and happy. She answered without missing a beat. If anything, she sounded proud of the fact.
Izuku gulped and closed his eyes.
And you feel like that now?
When I'm around you, yeah.
Holy shit.
Holy shit.
What the fuck was that supposed to mean? What the fucking fuck was going on? She was just beating the shit out of him 2 seconds ago, and now she was laying on top of him on the sweat-soaked sparring ring at Yue's gym.
Okay.
He just needed to ask her. Rumi was, if anything, forward.
Is this a sign?
He cracked one eye open to look at her. She smiled and moved off of him, but not completely. Her body was cast over him as she had him between her and the mat, her hair flowing off her shoulder like a waterfall of snow. She stopped when her face was right above his. Her smile was twisted with a look that made his spine tingle.
What kind of sign do you think it is?
That, he swallowed, his mouth going dry as he tried to maintain eye contact. He could do it. This was Rumi. That you might like me as more than a friend training partner. Her smile grew, and she leaned in close enough that he could feel her hot breath. And what are you going to do about it?
He swallowed.
I don't know.
Ask you out.
Great. Rumi jumped up. We have a date on Friday. Oh, we should go see a movie. Maybe The Batting Cages instead. We'll have to see. Anyways, come on, Izuku. We need to get going before they yell at us.
Did. Did he just get a date with Rumi? What the hell did he just agree to? Izuku was incredibly familiar with the concept of being nervous. He was nervous walking into his store for the first time. He was nervous whenever he made a phone call. He was nervous going to the bathroom with someone nearby. He liked to think that the confidence he had gained as a hero, and through his months of training and actually having friends that didn't growl at him, would have made him less nervous. It didn't. He was more brave and confident, but that nervousness remained. His nervousness was so great that he had to categorize it. There were mild times like when he was saying hello to his classmates, other times like when Koch-chan was being an ass, and making things worse for their entire class were intermediate. Then there were extreme cases like when he had grabbed onto All Might's leg, or when he had first met Ichako. Honestly, Izuku had thought that that was as nervous as he could ever get. He was wrong. Very wrong. Waiting for his date, with Rumi. His upperclassman, mentor, friend, incredibly violent, bunny-eared, red-eyed crush that had basically given him a handful of fetishes. Honestly, he wasn't exactly sure what the hell happened. All of a sudden they were training, then he was on the ground, then she just flopped on top of him, then bam. They had a date. A date with Rumi. This was peak nervousness. It honestly felt like one for all was currently being used on whatever part of his brain was in charge of making him nervous, because that had to be the biggest muscle in his body. Did he pick a good date? Was this something that Rumi would enjoy? Did Rumi actually like him? Why does she like him? Was what he was wearing okay? What was she going to wear? Did the websites he checked for dating advice help? He probably shouldn't have asked All Might. What if the date was fun, but he wasn't, and then she decided that she didn't want anything to do with him? What if he messed up? What if he overstepped his bounds? What if Rumi stood him up? What should he do? You look like you're about to X. Rumi's voice came from behind him, and his natural response was to jump. Not just a small surprised hop, but a jump that had him with well over a second of airtime before he landed down right in front of Rumi. Wow, I knew you'd like my outfit, but I didn't expect you to like it that much. Rumi laughed, smiling at him with all of her usual bravado. She wasn't wrong, he did like her outfit. Her long white hair was pulled into a ponytail, she had to know that he liked that look on her right. The top she was wearing was red and silver that hung over her stomach a bit like a curtain, while leaving her arms completely exposed. In short, she looked really, really hot. Pervert. Izuku felt like his face was going to explode with how hot it felt. Sorry, I didn't mean to. Rumi wrapped an arm around his shoulder and pulled him close. Dude, relax, we're on a date, I didn't dress up like this for you to not look at me. She gave him a light shove and looked him up and down. Besides, I like how you look too. A wink could be classified as a lethal weapon. But, just one thing. She reached up, her fingers running through his hair, and giving him another fetish. The sensation of feeling her fingers going through his hair was an instant addiction, almost enough to make him moan right there in public, so he settled for rolling his eyes, though he didn't get much of a choice. After a moment, Rumi withdrew her hand, her tongue sticking out just a bit. There, you look a lot better when your hair is all messy and stuff. Oh, thanks. He wasn't even mad that he spent 20 minutes trying to comb his hair. It was worth it for her to just mess it up like that again. Izuku turned towards their date location, an amusement park at a boardwalk. It seemed like the best place to take an active girl like Rumi. Plus she was the one to suggest it. Well, shall we? Yeah. Rumi grabbed onto his arm, smiling as she pulled him into the park. Let's go. When it came to the games, Rumi crushed everything. Her quirk enhancing her natural agility combined with her absolute desire to win no matter what made Izuku almost feel sorry for some of the vendors on the boardwalk. Hey Izuku. Rumi wagged her butt from inside of the batting cage, her fluffy white tail exposed as she hit another home run. Why don't you take the place of the pitching machine? I bet you can throw harder than this thing. Izuku laughed, honestly his cheeks had been hurting pretty much since their date started. Maybe, but I'd rather not get hit by one of your balls. Coward. Nope. You're just that strong. Rumi laughed and hit another ball, putting her entire body into it, and looking like a dynamic pose from a sports card. If you're trying to flatter me, you're doing a great job. I'm just telling you the truth. Hey, why don't you strike a pose? I'll get a good picture of it. Rumi laughed and twirled the bat, sending another ball flying. If you wanted a picture of me on your phone, all you had to do was ask. Do you want to go to the photo booth after this? Hell yeah. The photo booth was cramped, both he and Rumi were incredibly close to each other, with each of them trying to take up more space on the camera than the other, or at least Rumi was. Izuku was trying not to get too close to her. He wasn't quite sure what the boundaries were. Sure, Rumi was really physical, and she kept touching him, but he didn't want to mess this date up. But it has also been going really well. Well, at least Izuku thought it was going well. Get over here, dude. Rumi pulled him close. Come on, be a little more lively. I'm on a date with you, not your wallet. Right? Izuku laughed and leaned in close to Rumi, both of them looking towards the camera. He felt Rumi's hand on the back of his head, and could see her giving him rabbit ears in the reflection. So naturally, he stuck out his tongue. Rumi did the same. Each pose seemed to get more ridiculous than the last, with the start of it being him, and Rumi sitting there his face half off the screen, Rumi pulling him in, then the bunny ears. Other poses were scattered about, Rumi looking like she was dead, both of them trying to barely peek over the edge of the frame, him being super small looking up at Rumi, and one where she had jumped on his back, his shocked face on display, and only Rumi's leg and a peace sign were visible of her. That last one was chaotic as they stepped out of the booth to collect their prize. In addition to printing out a string of photos, the booth was advanced enough to send it to both of their phones. Rumi snorted at the photos, a happy smile on her face. "Hold on, Izuku, I have a better idea for a photo." "Huh? You want to go back?" She was on his back again, her powerful legs wrapped around his waist, and it felt like she could squeeze him in two, one arm held onto his shoulder, and her face was as close as possible to his as she held out her phone sideways, all set to take a photo. "Smile." Feeling her press up against his back like that, how could he not? Izuku smiled his best smile, his cheeks burning from both his blush, and just how much he had been smiling today. Rumi took the photo and showed it to him. "Holy shit, Izuku, we're cute as fuck." Izuku felt a rush spread through his body as he looked at that photo. It was perhaps the ultimate testament that he was on a date with Rumi, and that things were going well. Hopefully that photo would progress from a date to the start of their relationship. "Alright." Rumi squeezed onto his waist tighter. "Now, take us to the bumper cars. Go." Oh, he was giving her a piggyback ride. Right. Rumi was as brutal and reckless in the bumper cars as she was in everything else, but it was still a lot of fun. Was it possible to have too much fun? Honestly, Rumi didn't know how to answer that question. Part of her wanted to say yes, her and Izuku had too much fun today, and that was a good thing. They had laughed, ran around, basically went on every single ride and played every game on the boardwalk. But, there was a slight problem, some small frustration, that had been bothering Rumi for a while. The actual romance. Izuku had been nice, charming, and fun, pretty much what she expected him to be, but he was afraid to touch her. And it was kind of annoying. Even now, while they were riding the Ferris wheel, Izuku was sitting opposite of her. She wanted to hold hands. "So Rumi," Izuku muttered, his cheeks were red, and he scratched the back of his head as he looked at her. He was lucky he was cute. It was a shame that his heroic dumbass energy didn't translate to dating energy. Though, it wasn't like she was one to talk. She couldn't even ask him to do the things she wanted either. It was like her heart was going yes, while her brain was going hollop a minute. "I had a lot of fun today." Rumi nodded. "Yeah, it was a blast, Izuku. I knew dating you would be great. And the boardwalk was a great place. Mostly because there was a lot of things to do and that she had freaked out over the idea of not having anything to do with Izuku on their date, because all she really knew what to do with him was to train and fight, but how was she supposed to suggest a petting zoo? How were they supposed to have romance at a petting zoo? She also kind of wanted to just watch a movie on a couch or something and flop on Izuku again. When she had done that during their training, it had been completely on accident. And worse, she liked it a whole lot. Sure, she had wanted to get him to ask her out and it worked, but it had worked far too well on her. She wanted him to give her another piggyback ride, but that had just happened so spontaneously. "So, do you want to do something like this again?" Izuku asked, looking far more timid than she had ever seen him. It was pissing her off. It was pissing her off so much that she couldn't do anything. They both liked each other, right? So why were they both being so timid? Rumi pushed off her seat and slammed down next to Izuku, hard enough to rock their carriage just a bit. They were near the apex of the Ferris wheel now, and they had a great view of the Tokyo Bay at sunset. This was romantic, right? Sure, it wasn't a scream of victory after a blood-soaked fight, but it was close enough. "Izuku, I like you a lot, like a lot," she grabbed onto one of her ears, as she found herself looking down and away from him. Why was she being so cowardly over this? "And I really want to go on more dates with you, but, you need to know. I'm not fragile, I'm not going to break, if you touch me, I'm not going to run away whenever you try something. I want you to try stuff. Like hand-holding, carrying me, and..." He kissed her. Her first kiss was awkward, rushed, completely by surprise, her mouth had been open, whatever she was going to say died as her mind put all thoughts onto this kiss. Her eyes opened wide. Then, she slowly closed them, her entire body melting as Izuku finally gave her what she wanted from this. It ended far too soon, and Izuku leaned back. His cheeks practically glowing, as his entire body was sparking with his quirk energy stuff. "Was that what you wanted?" Izuku asked, his voice was low, almost a whisper, but at the same time dangerous. He finally figured out how to turn his heroic dumbass energy into romantic dumbass energy. And she liked it a lot. Rumi placed her hands on her lips, relishing the ghost of Izuku's kiss as she could still feel it. She spun, slamming both hands onto the bench behind Izuku, her knees on either side of his as she finally felt that barrier that had stopped her from acting further come crumbling down. "That was exactly what I wanted, Izuku," she licked her lips and smiled at him. "You're my boyfriend now. They figure out what exactly that meant later, but for now, kissy time. Having a girlfriend made him feel all kinds of tingly, not even the kind of tingling that came from using one for all a lot, but just a nice happy tingling feeling that made him feel like absolutely everything was right in the world. It was amazing. He loved it. Especially because whenever he saw Rumi, his heart would rush, and he just couldn't help but smile whenever he thought of her. Even if he wasn't really sure how to act around her, it was still amazing. They'd gone on 2 dates after school so far, and each time had been amazing, especially once Rumi decided that they could just start kissing. Izuka really didn't remember much about the movie they were supposed to be watching outside of the fact that someone complained about Rumi's ears, so they moved to the back, and Rumi decided that his lap was the best place to sit. He had a very aggressively kissy girlfriend. And it was awesome. Man, Izuku, Denki spun around and walked with his hands behind his head. You've been smiling a lot, did something happen? Of course, something happened. Tenya chopped the air with his hand and marched forward. He's proud of his recent development as a hero. Yeah man. Ijiro pushed Izuku on the shoulder as they made their way towards the cafeteria. He's been killing it in class. Ichako nodded and punched the air. Deku's gotten super tough recently. Izuku felt his cheeks burn at the praise. Sure he'd been doing better all things considered, but it really wasn't that much better, was it? If anything, it just felt like he was doing less worse. Like he had finally caught up to everyone else. Which was progress in a way. And a lot of it was thanks to Rumi. Maybe she should be a teacher. No, that sounded like a terrible idea. Rumi just worked out with him because apparently she was the right kind of crazy to help him deal with his quirk. Wait, Aizawa was crazy and he could teach. Maybe. Do you guys really think so? Izuka laughed, scratching the back of his head. I have been feeling like I was doing a bit better. Deku. Ichako flailed her arms. You've been doing more than a bit better. You've been amazing. You even beat Sero the other day in a race. And you. The shadow appeared right in front of Izuku and he felt that tingling again. Rumi landed in front of him, somehow avoiding all his fellow classmates. Her red eyes were the same level of crazy as they had always been, and her smile was massive. Boyfriend. Before he could even say hi, Rumi bounced up and gave him a quick kiss, sending several sparks down his back, and making him forget where he was and who was near him. All that mattered was Rumi. The kiss came to an abrupt end, and Rumi smiled dangerously at him. I can't mentor you anymore during class. But we're going to train after class. So make sure you do good during the final. Later. And just like that, she jumped away. Izuku blinked and felt his cheeks hurt from just how hard he was smiling. Eh? His friends all shouted, looking at him with a wide mixture of reactions, most of which were pure and utter shock. Izuku blinked and scratched his neck again. I guess we're not keeping that a secret. Eh? And that was how he became the first member of his grade to be in a relationship. Honestly, this simple act would have shocked the earlier him so much that he would have thought it worthy of being in the newspapers. So is he really your boyfriend? Yep. And he's really strong now? Yep. Is that why you're dating him? Nope. Huh? Then is it cause he's cute? Nope, but he is cute. Especially when I make him blush. Oh, you use the same way. Then why are you dating him? Why are you dating Yuyu? Cause she's awesome. And I'm dating Izuku because he's awesome. Rumi laughed and slapped Nejire on her back. Even if Nejire was taller than her, she still acted like a little sister, chaotic, horny one, so Rumi was going to treat her like one. Besides, Nejire was just universally cute. Nejire pouted and flapped her arms, her feet leaving the ground for a few moments. Rumi. That's not fair. You can use my own answer for your own. That's like cheating. You started dating Yuyu because you kept asking her for answers on the homework. That's different. As if. Rumi nudged Nejire and pointed up towards the building. Well, we're here, so let's go see if they'll let us in. It was time for finals at UA, and with summer vacation and the training trips on the horizon, Rumi was more excited than ever. This was her first summer vacation with a boyfriend. What should she do with Izuku? They should go to the beach, obviously. Oh, she needed to get a good swimsuit. And then there was all the training they could do. Oh. And BBQ. She wanted steamed carrots. So, what are you going to do for summer vacation? Rumi asked, looking at her periwinkle-haired friend. Are you going to Ai Island? I know that Tamaki and Mirio turned down the invite. I'm not sure, I mean, I don't really need a lot of fancy support items, and Yuyu's busy that week, so I wouldn't be able to go with her, and the last time I went they never answered my questions, and it was really annoying. Nejire pouted and flailed her arms. Besides, Ryukyu says I can spend as much time at her agency as I want this summer, and that she'd even let me do some modeling for her, so that would help me with the beauty pageant this year. Nejire jumped around, getting in Rumi's face and smiling widely. Do you want the ticket? They said they can change it between us really quickly. Because of how close the sports festival was, it would be really easy. Nah, I want to train with Izuku, besides, I'd just end up breaking stuff if I were to go. It was really hard to not break things, especially people, when she was just trying to have fun. It was a good thing Izuku was durable. you just want to make kissy faces with him. Nejire stuck her lips out and made a kissing motion. Or maybe more. If you want advice on sex, I can. Hand, meet Nejire's face. Rumi could feel the girl pouting in her palm. What would you know about sex with a guy? They have a penis. Nejire shouted loudly into Rumi's hand. It gets stiff and stuff. Rumi rolled her eyes and dropped Nejire back onto the ground, though the girl just ended up floating in the air instead. I know that much. Then are you going to do it with him? Rumi found herself pouting and even felt her cheeks grow warm as she thought about doing that with Izuku. Was it too soon? Would it be too soon later? During the summer? Should they do it for his birthday? But if they did it for his birthday, then that'd be weird, right? So, what should she do? Maybe? Oh, well, are you going to tell me when maybe becomes yes? No? Lame. Well, whatever, let's go do this. Rumi jumped, pumping her fist. Technically, they weren't allowed in here, but also, she technically was because of the mentorship papers she had to fill out on Izuku's progress. Nejire was allowed here, because literally no one could say no to her. It was her favorite way to use Nejire. Even the grumpiest of teachers couldn't resist the power of cute. Rumi tried to do the same thing, but apparently she just scared people that weren't on her level. Besides, Nejire was totally down for basically anything. Hopefully, we didn't miss it. Nejire muttered, as they bounced through the hallways of the monitor building. Nah, Nezu gave us the time, so we should be good. Rumi waved her hand and found parts of Izuku class hanging out in the monitor room. There was that one ice and fire guy, oh right, Endeavor's kid. Izuku said his name was Shoto, and then there was Tenya. He was there when Izuku didn't get credit for totally kicking Stain's ass. There were others, like that red spiky haired dude that called her manly once. Yo. Eraser Sensei. Eraser Sensei gave that same annoyed grunt he gave whenever anyone talked to him, and turned to glare at her. Rumi, what on earth are you doing here? And why is Nejire here too? Hi Sensei. Nejire bounced. We finished our finals and Rumi wanted to see her boyfriend fight in his finals, and we're also here for the mentorship thingy, because Rumi needs to. I get it. Eraser Sensei groaned, and rubbed his eyes. Just do me a favor and actually help teach the class. He gestured towards the number of students sitting and watching the conversation more than the actual monitors. Many of them looked mildly battered from their own tests, and a few more looked like they were on their way. Since you two are our top students, I'm sure you'll be able to provide some insight. Yeah, sure. She'd probably be able to say something, but she mostly just wanted to watch Izuku's fight, and if this was the price for admission, then it was easy to pay. Well, let's get started. Rumi let Nejire do most of the talking. Her chatterbox persona was perfect for explaining what was happening across the monitors, and her natural insight let her explain what the students should be doing. Rumi commented when she could, but almost all of her attention was on Izuku's fight against All Might. He was partnered with the ex-bloody guy. That looked exciting. And watching Izuku, watching him apply everything he learned into fighting All Might, how he dodged, attacked, used every part of the arena, used every part of his body, was making her fall in love with him all over again. When All Might let out a massive punch that wrecked the entire street, Izuku replied with a kick that was just as powerful. It was amazing how strong Izuku was, how much he had grown in the few months she had known him. Rumi licked her lips and smiled wider and wider. She couldn't wait to see where Izuku would stand in a year. She kinda hoped he'd be taller. But one thing was for certain, he passed with flying colors. School was out. It was once again for Rumi's favorite time of year, summer vacation. It was just a time where she could run around doing whatever she wanted, and going wherever she wanted. The freedom was intoxicating. Sure, there was the summer training camp later in the summer she had to worry about, but that was just kind of a bonus, because they'd end up going somewhere cool, and then she could kick Mirio's non-existent ass all day. Rumi grabbed onto the rocky cliff face that led to one of her favorite parts she found running around as an unsupervised teenager. Technically, it would be easier for both her and Izuku to just use their quirks and jump there, but what was the fun in that? Actually, that did sound like fun, maybe after they made their way to the top. Dangling from nearly 100 feet up off the ground, she glanced down towards her boyfriend. His overstuffed bag wiggling back and forth as he made steady progress up the cliff. So far he hadn't let the rope between them, their lone safety line, go slack, not bad for his first time free climbing. When she told him about this camping trip, he had been more than down for it. Though, he did start blushing a whole lot when she said that they would be alone for the whole weekend. Izuku's mom had been more nervous about it, but that ended when Rumi assured Inko that she had done this before, and that nothing was going to happen. Spoiler, something was going to happen. A lot of fun things were going to happen. Naked fun things were going to happen. That and it was Izuku's birthday. Well, technically his birthday was like a day ago, but this was technically more or less her present slash party for him. You doing alright, Izuku? She called, smiling down at him, the scars on his arms visible thanks to his tank top. Those muscles he had been working hard to develop were on full display as well. Now if only she could get him to take it off. Actually, that was going to be really, really easy. Ever since she had seen him fight All Might, she had been increasingly eager to find an excuse to pin him against something and have sex with him. But his home was a no-go, and her home was a no-go, and she didn't feel like just dragging Izuku into a love hotel. Besides, she wanted him to be just a bit rougher than what drywall could handle. And she had no idea if she was loud or not. She might be loud. She probably was loud. So instead, she planned to nail him under the stars miles away from civilization. That was totally romantic or some shit. That's fine, Izuku smiled up at her, a bit of sweat adorning his forehead. He made climbing the cliff look easy. We're almost there, right? The ground's getting a bit far away. You jump higher than this. Yes, but I'm still working on landing. Fair. Well, if you do fall, I'll catch you again. Tempting offer. But, if you make it all the way to the top, I'll give you a reward. Izuku stopped to look up at her again, his eyebrows raised. What kind of reward? Oh, you'll just have to find out. They finished the last 20 or so feet of their climb, and arrived at a slightly slanted plateau far enough away from Tokyo that they couldn't see Mount Fuji, let alone the city proper. A sparse forest made up much of the area, and the path that she once used was overgrown with grass and other shrubs. Through the trees, Rumi spotted their main goal. A small spring-fed lake that was always just the perfect temperature. It really felt like it was a hidden tropical paradise in the middle of Japan. Most of the animals around here were small rodents, birds, or other herbivores that could make the trip. Come on, Izuku, this way. Rumi unhooked the rope that bound her and Izuku and sprinted through the brush, well aware of the few scrapes she got from a few angry branches, but chose not to care. It was her choice to wear short shorts, mostly because she knew that Izuku's brain stopped working whenever she showed off too much thigh, which was why he tended to need a second whenever she showed up in her hero costume, which was pretty much Thigh City. Rumi arrived at the rocky shore of the lake and took in a great big breath of air, her arms extended out wide. It was so great being out in the middle of nature. Now to strip. Izuku walked up beside her and placed his bag down next to hers. His mouth was hanging open as he looked around the area, completely captivated. Where, Rumi, this place is? Izuku stopped working as he glanced at her the very moment she tossed her shirt and bra onto the ground. What's wrong, Izuku? She asked, wiggling her hips as she pulled off her pants and underwear. She kicked off her shoes and removed her socks before throwing her shorts at Izuku. Bunny got your tongue, Rumi? His voice cracked and his face was really red as he looked at her now discarded panties. Why are you? We're all alone out here, Izuku, she purred, slowly wading into the water, her feet sinking into the silt like sand that was mixed with large stones. She faced him, keeping her eyes locked on his, even while he struggled with finding some place to look. Why don't you join me? She pushed back, submerging her body into the water and floating back just a bit. The water was clear, just cool enough to be refreshing, yet warm enough that she didn't feel the same shock from entering the water. She pushed up and saw Izuku still standing there. Well, I'm waiting. Izuku tossed her panties to the side and started to strip as well, his boots being tossed to the side, his tank top next, followed by his shorts, showing off his naked well-muscled body to her. He was hard, and, from where she was, he looked large. Rumi swam away from Izuku as he dove into the water and sped towards her. She half let Izuku catch her, and half caught him, grabbing onto his waist as they found an area in the lagoon just shallow enough for him to stand. His arm wrapped around her waist as he pulled her in tight, one hand grabbing onto her breast. His firm, calloused, warm hands sent a shiver up and down her entire body. They kissed, her legs on his waist, her hands in his wet tangled hair, as she felt herself growing hornier and hornier, as Izuku's hands touched more and more of her. Their kissing continued. The undisturbed peace of this tranquil area allowed them both to just never stop. Her entire body felt like it was on fire, and Izuku was fueling it more and more, giving her exactly what she wanted with his every single touch. He kissed her, over and over and over, all over her body, sparing nothing from the top of her head to the inside of her ears. It was an endless cycle of foreplay that was as rewarding as it was frustrating. Rumi, Izuku's voice was deeper, his chest barely above the body, while she floated there hanging over him. We should set up before it gets dark. She hated that he was right. Fine, Sai sighed, wrapping her arms around his neck and placing her chin on his shoulder. But, don't think for a second we're not continuing right where we left off. I know, that's why I'm not even going to get dressed. Rumi had teased him for what felt like his entire life. First was the way she moved her hips as they did the hike, constantly making sure that he had a great view of her ass as she led the way, then making sure that she was above him during the climb. Then she just got naked. There was nothing flashy about it, no ceremony, just, bam, he got to see her fully naked just like that. Then, she baited him into the water, and promising him so much more. So now, it was his turn for payback. She was being so submissive. It felt so strange but so right. He adored Rumi's forwardness, but seeing her being meek, biting her lip as he continued to explore her body, the soft ways that she begged for things, it was so refreshing. And such a turn on. Izu. She moaned, her body arching, thrusting out her chest as she bit her lips. Please, she wiggled her hips, her eyes were bright red in the moonlight. I can't wait. Just do it. Rumi screamed, her back arching, fingers tearing into the sleeping bag, as he wondered if she was biting her lips hard enough to draw blood. Rumi's moans grew as he pressed into her. It was a calling, and he found himself groaning in the process, his eyes rolling as he felt his entire body both relax and stiffen. It was abrupt, but, somehow, he felt like an adult now. Keep going, Rumi called, her hips wiggling as her stomach muscles roiled with what he could only assume was pleasure. Don't hold back. Her hips locked around his waist. Give it all to me. He leaned forward, one hand on the ground and the other around her waist, as he continued to move his hips. He wasn't even sure what he was doing anymore, he was just doing whatever felt good, whatever made her feel good. Izuku! She cried, hands grasping forward and wrapping around his shoulders as she pulled herself up, and hanging off of him with her legs, arms, and hips, her powerful muscles allowing her to match his pace. She kissed him, moaning deeply as her body continued to tense. He felt her tighten up around him, squeezing him for all she was worth as she moaned and screamed all at once. That was her calling card to him, her signal that she had just came. Hard. And his body responded in kind. He felt his entire body pulse down into his fluff, as though he was trying to send everything into her. And then release. It felt like he spent ages cooming as his fluff pulsed, and pulsed, and pulsed inside of her, that one orgasm draining him dry. Izuku fell on top of Rumi, kissing her softly as his hips continued for no real reason. Holy shit, Izuku, Rumi moaned in between their kisses. I think I can get addicted to that. Izuku nodded. Yeah. That was. Wait. I did it inside you. Is that okay? Won't you get pregnant? Oh man, I wasn't thinking, Rumi, I'm... Shut up, it's fine, I won't get pregnant, she rolled her eyes, and grabbed her water bottle. I have a thingy. Oh? Now drink up, because this time, I'm going to be on top. Then tomorrow, you're going to fluff me against a tree, and then, we'll try doggy style, oh, and we should try cuddling sex, and... Rumi continued her long list of sexual escapades they were going to be doing this weekend. Was he really going to go from a virgin to a sexual expert in a single weekend? Yes. Rumi couldn't count the number of times that she fell in love with Izuku. Mostly because she couldn't keep track of just how often he went out and did crazy heroic shit. Honestly, it felt like he was trying to outdo her as the crazy one, but that just made it better. She still remembered each time he made her heart pound in her chest more than any other combat high in the world. It was the first fight she saw where he sacrificed everything to try and get the Todoroki kid to use his whole quirk. Then there was that brawl with All Might that it made it apparent just how much all of their training had been paying off for Izuku. After that, there was the fight on Eye Island. She hijacked Nejire's ticket and surprised Izuku, because she was mildly, just ever so slightly, completely, and utterly obsessed with him at this point, where she, Izuku, and All Might had fought against some guy that could control metal, and had an item that enhanced their quirk. One of her favors was watching Izuku kick a gigantic flesh monster that had been a mob boss into orbit, while he saved like the cutest white-haired girl in the entire world. Rumi and Nejire had instantly became the girl's big sisters, though for some reason nobody ever let her watch Iri solo, like there needed to be someone else there. Rumi still had no idea why. Iri was like 12 now. One of her all-time favorites though was when Izuku had saved not just her life, but everyone's life when he fought that white-haired boy that could destroy everything. She lost an arm during that whole fight. Mei built her a metal one. Mei was good people. There were dozens of other times that Rumi had fallen in love with Izuku over and over again. And even though she was currently the number 5 pro hero, and Izuku was just now starting to enter into the top 10, she was his number 1 fan. Hey, Izuku. Rumi dove onto the couch where her boyfriend of like 8 years was currently sitting. They had moved in with each other, well, kinda. She had gotten a house when Izuku had graduated UA, and then basically stole all of his stuff, and told him they were living with each other. Sometimes she wondered if she was a crazy girlfriend or not. Well, she probably was just a bit crazy. Hey Rumi, Izuku didn't even hesitate to place his hand on her stomach. How was your run? Mount Fuji is cold. You went to Mount Fuji? A small voice asked, and Rumi became aware that Iri was here as well. Oh right. They were supposed to watch her, huh? Oh, that meant a pajama party. And ran there. Rumi shrugged on Izuku's lap, really content to just flop on her boyfriend and soon-to-be fiancé. Well, it was more like a couple of jumps, and just for fun. I also fought some crime on the way, and hey, she swatted Izuku's chest. Remind me to see if we can get Mei to adjust the settings on the arm, I think it's too sensitive now. Sure, we can head there later, unless you'd like to go see Mei, Iri. The most adorable 12-year-old in the entire world blinked, opened her mouth, closed it then shook her head. That was the kind of sass that Rumi had tried to shove in Iri's mind from a young age. It beat Nejire's influence. That was why she was the favorite big sister. And the fact that she was always with Izuku probably had nothing to do with it. No thanks. Mei, kinda scares me. Izuku blinked. Mood. Hey. And I don't. Rumi kicked her legs and flopped more aggressively on Izuku's lap. Crap. She had flopped and couldn't get up. Stupid, bunny brain. You both need to learn to fear the bun. It's hard to be afraid of you when you have a fluffy white tail coming out of your butt. Iri snickered. So sassy. Rumi loved it. And I know how much you enjoy cuddling. Izuku grabbed one of her ears at the tip and began to rub the ever so slightly sensitive spot in a really good way. Her legs started twitching. And I know all of your weaknesses. Oh yeah. Rumi wiggled in his lap and looked right up at him. Well, I know yours. What? I love you. Izuku's face turned red. His weakness was forward blunt women. And if Rumi was anything, she was a forward blunt woman. I love you too. Rumi looked over towards Iri and smiled at her. Hey, Iri, you going to be our flower girl? Ha. Ha. Both Izuku and Iri said nearly at the same time. Rumi hopped up and went to Izuku's hiding spot he thought she didn't know about and grabbed that ring he had been meaning to give her. She dumped the little black box that had a very pretty ring onto Izuku's lap and held her hand out to him. I'm tired of waiting, do the proposing thing. Huh? What? How'd you find this? How'd you think you could hide like anything from me? Rumi? You left the receipt on the table. Fuck. Language? Iri shouted and pulled out her phone. By the way, I'm filming this. Nejire says I have to say that when I do it. Hopefully the it was filming, and the do it wasn't the actually doing it. It didn't matter how old Iri was, she was going to remain cute and innocent and wholesome and single. Rumi wasn't afraid to break knees. Great. Rumi shouted, her metallic hand on her hip as she waited for Izuku. Now hurry up and ask me to marry you, so I can say yes and tackle you onto the couch, knocking it over while we kiss, and Iri says that's gross. What? But don't you want something more romantic? Izuku fumbled, taking the ring out of the box and standing. I mean, I'm happy you want to marry me, but this isn't how I had it planned at all. Unless you want to go find a villain that will be life or death for both of us. Are there any? Then you missed the most romantic time to propose when you saved my life all those years ago. I was 16. So? I would have said yes. Fine. Izuku got down on one knee and held out the ring. Rumi, will you marry me? Hell yeah. Rumi held out her hand and let Izuku put the ring on her finger. Now for the actual wedding. That's going to be a pain in the butt to plan. Hey Iri, want to go to the store to get us stuff to celebrate with? Are you two going to have sex again? Iri asked, pocketing her phone and slipping it into her pocket. Cause if so, I'll go to the arcade. Who ruined you? You? Fair? Thanks for listening. I do hope you enjoyed. If you want the next part of this video, like, subscribe, and comment down below, and turn on that bell notification, and also check out the other videos that I have created and enjoy. See you in the next video. Peace.